Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You can see by how I'm dressed, I've sort of made a sacrifice and put a tie on today for you. I think Amina Syed, when she walked in, she must have had the shock of her life to see me dressed like this. But so it's in your honor, and I'm very pleased to be here. I can see that you can see from the screen here that I was going to introduce myself, but I've had a very nice introduction already. So we can skip all this and go on. All I will say is, at the bottom is Oxford University Press. The first time I came to Pakistan was in 1975, and we were just passing through. And that's a long story. I often tell teachers this when I'm talking to them. And it's a lovely story, and it's about a man in Karachi who gave me some money and asked me, when I carry on in life, I should repay that money to somebody else. When you're in trouble, you will be helped out. And this was a man from Karachi who helped me in 1975. So that was a very nice experience in Pakistan. And then later on, when I had worked at my father's school in India and went back to the UK to live and work there, Amina Syed heard about me, and she came to see me and asked me up to Oxford, and that was my association with Oxford University Press Pakistan. So that started in 1989, and I came to write science books and then social studies books, English courses, art and craft, and a number of books, almost 100 books for Pakistan, which are being used in some of your schools, I'm sure. So, I'm very, very pleased and very honored to be invited here to speak to such a eminent collection, I should say, of eminent people. I'm not given to public speaking as much as I'm not given to wearing a tie. But I've been in many classrooms and I've talked to children, and you can see that I'm kind of engaging already. I'm not standing behind a podium. And so when I heard the title of this conference, Engage, Teaching and Learning, I started thinking about what engagement meant. Does it mean participation? Yes. We go in as teachers into schools, and we're the teacher, and we expect, and we organize, and we get children to participate. But if that participation is not shared, and it's a two-way process, then it doesn't become participation. It becomes a sort of dictation. I'm creating a dictatorial system. You sit when I tell you to sit. You stand when I tell you to stand. You play when I tell you to play. You read when I tell you to read. And there's no kind of participation. There's no shared involvement. And then that leads to disengagement. So I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking about what it means. It means participation. It means enjoyment. We don't get into any kind of environment if we don't enjoy it. If you're there under duress, because you have to be there, you have to be there to study, you have to be there to get examinations, then there's no enjoyment, and if there's no enjoyment, there can be no engagement. So, enjoyment is a very critical aspect of this engagement. So captivation, does it mean this engagement, does it mean a sort of captivation, and I don't mean imprisonment here, because we put children into a very artificial atmosphere. All the world outside is their enjoyment. All the world outside contains the things they love, their family, their pets, their television, their freedom to roam, and so on. And we put them into classrooms. So the captivation I'm talking about is through innovative and creative teaching, and if the teacher can increase his or her own skills, then this engagement can take place. Somebody told me about the Aga Khan University's Exam Board's middle school program, and I looked at what their program was all about. Listening, reading, observation skills, very good. This takes place from the primary. It should take place in the primary schools. Information gathering, very important. If it's done in the right way, information gathering is extremely important. I went to a school once, and they did some information gathering before I got there. The information gathering was to gather information about me, so that a little brochure or individual brochures could be presented to me when I got there. And I was presented with all these lovely pictures and drawings and so on, folders, and I couldn't read them all there, so I took them home. When I got home, I found half of them were about a lawyer in New York who had the same name as I did. So that information gathering was not a very useful exercise. So it has to be well supervised. Okay, communication skills, very important. Everything in education, everything in the school depends on communication. Whether you're teaching science or social studies or English or art or craft, communication skills, very important. And important in life later on. Interpersonal skills, yes. And in all my books, which try and get in something to do with interpersonal skills, getting children to work together, cooperating, and so on. Critical thinking. This is a difficult one. How do you get people to think critically? If people, for example, yesterday, I asked teachers to have a guess about something. I was running a workshop, and I said, guess. I'll ask you the same question. Guess how far it is from that wall to this wall, in meters. Anybody like to guess? See, okay, here's a brave man. Because normally, we don't want to put our hands up in case we give a very stupid answer. Or we think it's going to be a stupid answer because we haven't got a clue. So we are scared to put our hand up, and we look around. And when, you know, oh, everybody's put their hand up, then I can put my hand up. So here's a brave man, sir.
30 meters?
That's a, anybody different from that?
35.
Okay, so it's critical thinking comes from the ability for anybody to give an opinion. Yeah? If you're going to think about something, think about it, critical thinking, and then you're going to give your own opinion about it. That becomes, if you want an opinion, people are not really able to in class. This happens all the time. When I ask questions which demand critical thinking, people are scared to give an answer. Children are scared to give an answer because we equate it with being wrong, morally wrong, and right. So if you get good marks, for example, you're morally good. If you get bad marks, you're morally bad. So critical thinking is very difficult to teach. You have to allow it to happen. Responsibility. When I talk a little later on about our experiment in education in India and the running of a rural school, you'll find that this word responsibility is a very critical, again, a very critical word or a critical idea. How do you teach it? We never give children responsibility. We give some children responsibility by putting a sash on them and calling them prefects, but we don't give them responsibility. We don't give them responsibility in their classroom. It is not their classroom. And that come on later on to ownership, which is part of what my talk is about. Teamwork. Yes, teamwork, but again, dictated usually by the person in charge, the teacher. So it's got to be some sort of involvement from children in decision making. Creativity and innovation, same thing. Now, that's the Aga Khan University's program, and it's highly commendable, and I'm really pleased to see that something is done, being done in that field at the middle level. What about the primary level? I'm concerned more with the primary level, and that's where it should start. So we have to start. I think this is a good initiative, but all of you are principals, and I'm sure all of you have primary sections as well. And that's where it should start, so that by the time the children get to the middle school, they're already well groomed in this way of functioning. Goals of the school and for individuals. We have goals of the child should learn to read, to write, to do a bit of mathematics, to know about the world around them, so science and so on. This doesn't fit in because we can't examine it. How do we examine, or how do we give marks for passion? I don't mean, you know, passion as in cinema, not that sort of passion. I mean, be passionate about something, to be effusive about something. To, when you love something, show that you love it. When you hate something, well, we all know that when we hate something, we show it in many different ways by throwing things. Creativity. We want children to be creative. We want them to be have moral courage. You can't evaluate these things, and therefore somehow they slip out of the curriculum. We can evaluate mathematics, we can evaluate science learning, we can give marks for all these things, but these things we can't evaluate, and so we say, oh, all our kids are good, or they have moral courage, but we can't evaluate it, so it actually doesn't feature in any. Okay, looking at things differently, how do we judge that? In class, I went to a class 2 days ago at the school, and as I went in, I said to the children, ask me a question if you want. They looked blank, no. Principal standing behind them, they're all looking at her. Okay, is it okay if we ask a question? Going on in their heads. Eventually, I said, there's one little boy in the front, and after 2 minutes, we couldn't keep him quiet. He had questions, he was, whoa, and he was kind of active. And I said to the teacher, I know this is one of your children who thinks differently. But that child had it in him. He was born with it. There's no way of teaching that. But there's a way, if you're a good teacher, to allow it to happen, to allow it to flower, to allow it to develop, and not crush it. So thinking outside the box, this again, to get people thinking outside the box. For example, in some of my science books, I put in questions like, design a rat trap. If you're asked to design something, we don't want 500 of the same answer. That's not going to give us any development. That's not going to take us any little bit forward. Everybody is going to produce the same answer, and everybody who gets 100%, or some who don't do it as well as others, will get 75%, and some who don't do it at all will get 0%. But nobody is thinking outside the box. Nobody is thinking of an innovative and new way of doing something. Using and treating the world well. When we look at people who are coming out of our establishments, we want them to be good people. We want them to treat the environment properly. You tell them in class, don't throw rubbish on the ground. You say, pick up paper, pick up paper, pick up paper. And who throws the paper on the floor in the first place? They do. So your environment in the classroom is important, and the environment outside is important, and then the blue whale is important, and the green world, and so on and so forth. Good relationships, how to get on with other people. How do we test that? Do we get angry? Do we get irritated? Do we have patience? Diligence and perseverance. Do we give them wanting to learn, wanting to carry on, wanting to do the work, regardless of whether the teacher is there? Are these people coming out of school as responsible people able to do that without the teacher or the stick? The stick not meaning a physical stick, but that authority standing there over them. So these are some of the goals. I think integrity, self-respect, We want them to have integrity. We want them to have self-respect, some worth, some idea of what their own worth is. How do we judge now a school or a person? The way we always do it, and I know that we were talking about assessment and digitalization and so on, and this is the easy stuff, is we can say, oh, so-and-so's got a degree. Oh, this one has 100 marks. When schools put out these big posters saying, this one has got the first rank, and this one has got the third rank, and that one's the fourth rank, we don't say this fellow is an utter terrible, the most terrible person you could ever meet in your life. You know, he's a nasty character and so on. Ah, but he got 475 marks, so he must be a very clever individual. The employer is not really interested in that, as somebody said earlier. The employer is interested in, can I work with this person? Can he get on with other people? Is he passionate? Can he think outside the box and so on? Not that he's got 490 marks. And if you actually look now at the Cambridge University, Oxford University, Harvard, and so on, they have their own interviewing process, and they interview people who are coming there, students, and they don't really worry about the marks. The marks are not that important. Yes, you need a certain level of qualification, but at the end of the day, it's who you are and whether you can think outside the box and so on. So, marks and exam. Discipline. Discipline, self-discipline, not something that is from outside. Okay, we judge then people on honesty. Are they honest? Are they straightforward? And in school, a lot of the examples that we give children are about actually dishonesty. A teacher, for example, will be behaving in a particular way, and when a principal comes along, that behavior changes. So when that behavior changes, the children actually pick this up. Okay, trust, cooperation, aesthetic awareness. These are some of the things that if we have a care of the environment, sympathy and love, responsibility, and a desire to learn. If we can give children a desire to learn, then our battle is won. Engagement by creating interest, making learning enjoyable, captivating the imagination, bringing the world into the classroom. These are things that teachers should be doing. Cooperating and sharing. And it's not going forward. Yep. Now we come to what my talk is really about, and that is engagement is possible through ownership. Ownership, I don't mean giving children ownership of the classroom, but I mean giving them some kind of inclusion. So let's work together. Our experiment in Neelbagh in India was about, this was some of the principles that we had, freedom to come or not. Your children, of course, don't have that freedom. Our children were free to come or not. There was no obligation. Cooperation, not competition. We had 26, we started with 26 children, and we had a family group. And I asked teachers how you can deal with a family group. If you have a child of 6 years old, and a child of 8, and a child of 10, and 12, and so on, up to 14, in the same classroom, how do you teach them? You can't. What we do is we put children of the same age in different classes, and we make them 6th standard, 5th standard, 4th standard, and so on. Here, you've got a teacher who's sitting there with 26 children, and they're all of different ages. So it changes the emphasis from teaching to learning. You are creating an environment in which children can learn rather than you're dictating what they should do every day. Grades, we had no grades. Depends on the speed of learning. If you have 26 children, even if you have 26 children in the normal schools, you have children of the same age. But you've got 26 individuals, and those 26 individuals will go at different speeds. There's no way that they can all go at the same speed. So what happens then is some are being dragged along and others are being stopped from going too fast. In this system, because you had no grades, a child could do two books in 1 year. Some children, because there's a festival and they're ill and so on and they miss school, they would do maybe one book in 2 years. But they were still progressing and still going forward rather than being told you're a failure or you're a great boy. The ones who were going too fast, of course, we slowed down. There were no tests. There was self-evaluation and there was evaluation every time, every day. We didn't have tests. Academic progress was not equated with morality. So if a child doesn't learn something or couldn't learn something, it doesn't mean that that child is bad. It just means that you have to find another way of teaching that child. No punishments. If a teacher comes late, we don't punish the teacher. If a child comes late, we don't punish the child. So, responsibility. We had the children were responsible for the school. They had control of their work. I don't mean that they devised their curriculum. For example, if you had 9 o'clock, you had English, they would bring their English, they would come into the class and they would sit down. The child is responsible, so the child could do copywriting to start off with. They could take their reader and do some reading and then answer the comprehension questions if they wanted to. They could take the workbook and do work from the workbook. But they were responsible for their own work within that time frame. The teacher could then say to individuals, come here, look, show me your work, and so on. Or you need help, help somebody else. There's a cooperation going on. And this went on. Children developed a sense of responsibility. Also, they had ownership of their environment. We'll come to that. We had maths, languages. The children ended up learning 5 languages, social studies and science, all basic things. We also had carpentry, art and crafts. That's where you learn discipline. Because materials, you can't manipulate materials. If you manipulate them in the wrong way, you make a pot, it will break if you don't make it in the right way. So the materials give you that discipline. If you cut wood in the wrong way, it will break. Yeah. So we did a lot of things like carpentry, pottery, art and craft. We had a dispensary, so the children, one at a time or two at a time, they would leave class and go and help at the dispensary. So you're helping somebody else. You're learning about medicine to a certain degree. You're dressing wounds and so on. Every day we had a snack because these were very poor children from a poor environment, and they would help make the snack. Poetry, a lot of poetry. I ask teachers when I go and do workshops, how many of you read poetry? You ask your children to write poetry, and when they leave school, nobody reads any poetry. Nobody reads a novel. If I asked all of you today, how many of you are reading a novel? Few hands are going up, but not a lot. And actually, if I said, don't put your hands up because I'm going to ask you questions about the novel you're reading. Then I sort of, my hand wasn't really up. We did a lot of drama. I had a niece from England who came to the school because they were having some family problems. And she came at the age of 15. And we said, we'll take you through your O-levels. What do you have to do? We'll get your syllabus, we'll get the, well, you have to do Shakespeare, you've got to do Macbeth. Oh, I hate Shakespeare. Okay, don't worry, we'll make it exciting for you. And you have to do Tennyson. What's that? She said, what? he's a poet of some kind. we'll make it interesting for you, don't worry. And we've got village kids there. My own 3 kids went to the same school. I'll show you some slides at the end. So they're all, every week, we had play reading. And we asked our kids, look, you've done Macbeth, but Nicola has to do Macbeth, and she didn't like it very much. So do you mind doing it again? And the kids said, no, because they love Shakespeare. Shakespeare, you know, ever related to their lives. You have the Merchant of Venice, you have Romeo and Juliet, you know, and if you look at these things, they all relate to the lives of these people in the village. So they really kind of related or saw that Shakespeare was a really great guy. And you don't have to read the whole thing and understand it, and even I don't understand it fully, and you know, people even who've got degrees in English literature and so on find it difficult, but you can enjoy it, and you can take speeches out of it, and you can make it fun. And we made it so much, the children, the village children, made it so much fun for my niece who'd come from England with all her education of 15 years, that she began to enjoy Shakespeare. And she eventually passed her O-levels on her own and did very well. So drama, very important. I tell teachers all the time, any story that you have in your textbook, turn it into a drama. Get the children to dramatize it. Expression, passion, feeling, trust, courage, it all comes from doing drama. Right. Building. All the school buildings were built by the children. We closed the school for 2 weeks and said, right, build your building. You want desks? We close down, we go to the carpentry shed and all of us make desks. You want mats? Let's sit down and weave the mats. We did all that. Pottery. Discussions and thinking. Very important. Children want to ask you questions that they can't find the answers to in textbooks. God. About life. About relationships, about family. Why do people get angry? How is a child going to find out? Why is he angry with me? You can't read about this, and you can't find any literature on this, so you can't say, oh, go and read a book about it. You know, you can't, in those days, no Google, but you can't say, here's an encyclopedia, have a look and see what anger is all about. A child is not going to be able to understand half the... First of all, it's written by some psychologist, so they're not going to understand it. But if you have a discussion with kids, and you say, right, we're going to ask a question, and then we're going to try and find an answer to it, and you sit around in a circle once a week, you will find some very, very interesting questions come up. Something that is worrying somebody, it will be discussed. Maybe you don't find any answers, but you will find lots of questions coming up. So ownership. The keys to the school were with the kids. It was their school. Books and materials. We had 3,000 books in the classroom. We had all the materials in the classroom. I've been to umpteen schools in Pakistan, and only the other day I was in a couple of schools and in the library talking to teachers, and you have lovely cupboards full of books. And I said to one of the, I said, this is a library. Oh, do the kids come? Yes, they come once a week, on a Wednesday or whatever it is. They come into the library, but there's a librarian and so on. I said, oh, just open that cupboard and pass me that book. And she pulled the, this teacher pulled the cupboard, and it was locked. I knew it was locked. But if, and I know in the principal's offices, if I come to some of your offices, I will find the most wonderful books in your room, untouched by human hands. Poor old Oxford University Press donates some books to the school, and they go in a cupboard. And they are touched because the guy comes once a week and he goes with his duster and he dusts them, you see. But no, but they're in pristine condition. The day they were printed, same thing. They're no use to man or beast. You might as well have a big picture up there on the wall and say that's a picture of books. But the real books should be in the library. So, and sometimes books will walk. They develop feet and they will walk. How are we teaching trust? How are we teaching responsibility? If we don't give trust and responsibility and ownership to the children to look after the books, I tell teachers again, every classroom in this country has to have its own library. Every classroom in this country. I'm not talking about every school, because if the library is there and if the librarian goes on leave, the library is locked. No learning can take place, no reading can take place because the library is locked. If you have a shelf in the classroom, and if you have some books on display, and if the children all bring one book each, 25 books, that's your library. That's the start of your library. But it is theirs. The ownership is theirs. The responsibility is theirs. The trust is theirs. But the reading takes place. The reading and the enjoyment of reading, that is what we are trying to teach, something that you take with you after school. It doesn't come if you don't give ownership. Servants. There were no school servants. Everybody in the school was a servant at some stage. We had a duties roster. All the names were up on one side, and all the duties up beside them. Those duties were rotated. Every week, we changed the duties. One child, bring the water into the classroom because you had to have drinking water. There were no taps, no flowing water. You had to get it from the well. You had to put the kuja, a pot, in the corner with the glass, make sure those were clean. Somebody had to arrange the books on the shelves. Somebody had to take the desks outside. They were only small desks, you'll see a picture of them. And somebody had to bring them back in. Somebody had to sweep the classroom. Teachers, children, all mucked in. Everybody got dirty. Everybody did the work. It was their school. They built it. So there was homework. They went for 2 hours of homework in the evening. They lit the lamps. They took the school key. They went to the school building, opened it, went in, sat down with all the books around them, and did 2 hours of homework. But we never set any homework. It was up to them to devise what they wanted to do. If they wanted to do maths, they would do some maths. If they wanted to do some science, they would do some science. If at the end of the day, the next day or the day after, we look at the science book and we see that they haven't done much science, apart from the science that's being done in the classroom. And then it's the job of the teacher to say, hey, come here. Look, this is so interesting. Try this. And if the child is not getting on with a particular textbook, change the textbook. If you give, for example, an explanation, is it last 5 minutes? Thank you very much. Yeah. So if you try, they say, I'm teaching and teaching and teaching every day. I teach this child and he's a fool. He can't learn anything. No, it's your job as a teacher to find a different route. If you can get in your car and you can't get from here to, Korangi, and it's blocked, traffic, you find a different route. Sometimes in Karachi it's not possible, but with a child, with a child, it is always possible to find a different route, to appeal to him. A child is grumpy. I'm not doing any work today. Your job as a teacher not, you're a bad boy. You shouldn't smile. Come on, smile. I'm smiling for you, not for me. I don't feel the smile in here. I'm smiling because you told me to smile. And the minute you turn your back, I can go back to my usual stuff. Yeah, and we're teaching trust and honesty and discipline. So this goes on and we carry on and carry on. The job of a teacher is to find a way to get whatever it is into that child's head, but not by pouring, by interesting him and approaching it in different ways. Because the child is not just a receptacle, but they have feelings too, and they have emotions too, and they have different backgrounds and different hang-ups. Okay, so now we come to some pictures, because we only got a few minutes left. That was the first building we built, way back in 1965. This was the village. This is the countryside, so fairly arid, but they're very, same temperature as Karachi. We went up to 40 degrees, 44 degrees in the summer. We just melted because there's no electricity at that time. So there means no fans and no air conditioning. No pankawala. Those days are gone. This was the school building. You can see NB there, made in the carpentry shed. All the bricks for this building, it was made of bricks. The bricks were not purchased. The bricks were made in our kiln by the children, and then they constructed everything. The windows and doors were made by a carpenter. And of course, the tiles they didn't make. Otherwise, it would have been a very leaky school. this is the countryside, and that's our sort of complex later on, much later. This is in the 70s. These are the desks, and everybody, including the teacher, is sitting on the floor on little mats. You can see there, this was the first classroom, so there's not much space. But you can see there all the books on the shelf, right? There's an open access. There's my father and mother. There's books, again, on the shelf, materials. Dictionaries. When a child asks you a word, the child probably asks you the meaning of a word so that you fall off the pedestal because you don't know the meaning of the word, and he knows you don't know the meaning of the word. So he asks you the meaning of the word to make you look a fool. And you say, don't ask that now. You're going to go, do, get on with your work. I'll tell you that. And then you go off and you read about this and say, obliquely, yes, it means so and so and so and so the next day. But you unfooled him because he's a wise kid. So here, in an English class, when a child asks, they don't ask you what the meaning of a word is. They have a dictionary. And they look it up. And if that child doesn't, or isn't able to find it in a dictionary, he can ask the next child. There's nothing wrong. That's not copying. That's getting some cooperation and getting some help from other people. It takes only a minute. It takes only 2 minutes. You're either giving time or you're taking somebody's time. This was a science lab. We had to move science to a different building because we started keeping chemicals and things like that. So that was under lock. That little door on the side was a storeroom, and the other one was used for craft and a bigger room for craft. This is a lineup in the early days, so you can see the different heights. They're all in the same class, all in the same class. This is the lineup. You can see three of my kids in that lineup. Little boy this side in the front, and then a girl and another one. Now they're marching in, disciplined manner. In the classroom, all the books. So you want an encyclopedia? Go get it. Reference. We talk about doing things compartmentalized. We say we will teach them reference skills. The reference skills that you learn at this level, go and find a book and you will find the answer. Right. Here's four kids, time to eat, play. Lots of playing, lots of running around the countryside. Drama. Again, two girls, my daughter on the right here. Embroidery, boys did embroidery, girls did embroidery. Boys did carpentry, girls did carpentry. There was no difference. Yeah, and I always tell the story, all the ladies, they spoil their sons. You know, you spoil them rotten. And I was telling them yesterday in the workshop, I said, it's your problem, all the men behave in the way they do because of the ladies. When the son is little and he's sitting on the chair, mommy, mommy, book lagrai, roti, chahiye, roti. Mommy comes running and gives him a roti. Yeah, you are la, what do you want? Yeah, you take, cow, 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 beta, cow. And he's getting fatter and fatter and fatter, this little fellow. He can't walk. There he goes. Then a few years later, like 27 years later, he's still sitting there watching the television. And he's still saying, mommy, roti, bukla. By this time, all the girls who've been doing all the ironing and stuff, they've gone married and gone off somewhere else. And the mother has to do all this now, and she's ironing his shirt so that he can sit there and watch television, carry on. And she says, son, just go in the kitchen and get some food. And I look, see, I'm busy. Mommy, kitchen kidder hai. Or kitchen kya hai? So we spoil them. So here, all the tasks were shared. And it's amazing, you know, you think, how many, you don't do any of the physical work in your schools. You have people to do the chai lao, and somebody will bring the chai. Here, they all did their own work. They made hats, had fun, they made puppets. That was a kiln where we made our bricks and made our pots. This is all sitting down and eating on the floor. We had eye camps for people who had cataracts. So our children then were involved. Close the school, 2 days, doctor comes along, big bed set up, no electricity, so he's shining a torch. And the first time one of our kids helped with this, he was shining the torch, and the doctor's just out and made his first incision. And the boy who was holding the torch went, because there was blood all over the place, you see. And I was taking photographs at the back, like this. I had to drop my camera and grab this. Hey, where's the light? Where's the light? So, adventure. There's another of my daughters sitting there, and a son. That's me. This boy on the bottom here, on the right, he's teaching economics at Budapest University. And he would have been looking after goats had he not had the opportunity. You're clapping for him, not for me. You're not clapping for us, I hope, because we created the opportunity. It was his hard work, his perseverance, his dedication, his knowledge that took him where he is. So some of our kids did that, and some of the kids are still back in the village. Anyway, this is what I meant about ownership, and if we can get kids to own their own schools, they will learn a lot of these lessons of trust, honesty, and so on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let me break the ice. Thank you for your... Nicholas, right? Is that the name?
My name?
Yes, Nicholas. Nick. Thank you for very, very engaging, as you said, engaging, we're using this word, presentation and... for presenting to us what I would call island of hope, oasis of hope, through your school that your parents, your father, and you are working in India. A question I have is a check of reality check. You know, all these examples show possibility, but they remain very isolated. The reality of schooling today is one of competition, one of tests, one of examination, one of punishment, one of rote memorization, one of all other kind of things that are opposite to what you're saying. The larger reality, the sociological understanding that is needed to be presented in your presentation. Therefore, my question to you is, are we, when we do this kind of exam, this kind of
experiments,
are we isolating ourselves from this larger political economy, or are we saying that are we kind of missing what sure. The reality is?
I get the point. The point is, in case nobody heard it, I think your point is that this is a case in isolation. It's an oasis. You may go there and you may say, oh, what a lovely school this is, what a lovely establishment. But can the work that is being done there be applied on a much wider scale? And it is being done on a wider scale because I'm here talking to you, in the sense that it's translated into textbooks. So I have put myself or some of those ideas into the textbooks by the questions you ask, by the exercises you set, and so on, in one way. That example became a very popular example in India, and a lot of schools, there were a lot of offshoots that worked on those principles. Given the constraints of a bigger school, a bigger environment, perhaps a city environment, and so on. But some of the principles there, for example, the ideas of trust and honesty and ownership, they can be applied anywhere. They can be applied in your schools. It just takes one enlightened principle to say, okay, what's wrong with having a library in every classroom? Why do we not have it? We're teaching reading. We want them to have a love for reading, and yet we deny them books. How can we do it? The two don't, you know, they just don't go together. I can't see. If you put me in a school, I will make sure that books are readily available to children, that they are torn, that they are destroyed, and in time cared for, looked after, cherished, and read over and over again. Your children in classes are sitting there with one textbook, and the child is so intelligent that he can read that textbook in the first month. We are not educating that child. We are holding that child back because of the system. So we have to change the system. We have to have books in the classroom so that when the child finishes that exercise with all the exercises, we say, don't sit there quietly and be disruptive, because he's going to be disruptive, because we are making him bored. He's going to start doing stuff. He's going to start throwing things. And if you say, have you finished your work? Yes, I have finished my work. So what do you do then? Take a book from there, or go and help somebody else. We don't do this. And this is something that can be done, you know, from this example. And it is being done. It is being done.
Thank you, Nicholas, for a very interesting presentation. My question, in fact, you answered my question, because I was going to ask, how do we leverage this beyond a single Neelbagh to all the schools in the rural and urban landscape of Pakistan? And I think you have answered partially by implanting principles of it in bits and pieces. But how could we have a school like Neelbagh in toto, at least in some parts of Pakistan?
You mean on a bigger scale?
Yes, leverage it beyond one particular school which is doing very well. How do we have a much larger...
You know that you already have this idea in Pakistan? And do you know where it exists? It exists in every single rural government school in the country. You have single teacher schools, and you're not just re-educating or trying to educate or pretending to educate 26 children. These schools have 150 children in them with one teacher. You go up to Swat and you go up to the northern states, or you go out to Sindh and you go to any dusty village, and you will see a building which is a concrete block, and in it there's one teacher, and he's got 60 children, and they're in the first standard, second standard, third standard, fourth standard, fifth standard. Now, is this not the same example? But we have to change. The teacher there has no idea how to deal with this multi-level group. And he teaches the first standard, hey, ka, pa, ma, and the fifth standard, they're falling asleep. And if you looked at those figures, and those are very interesting figures, you see in primary schools, there are millions of kids. And in secondary, they're less, and then in the tertiary level, they're much less. They're dropping out. In 5 years, in a primary school, in a village, you will find that the dropout rate is about 80%. On average, I'm just picking a figure out. But I know for a fact that if you put 30 children who come into the first standard and you say, ah, ah, e, e, o, o, or, ye kai, ho kai, ye ra, 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 how long will you go and stay there? Go, oh, 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 oh. And they're not even reading a book. They will go, ka, ka, ba, ba, e, o, o, o. Truck is going there, and they're looking over there, and they're, I'm learning to read. And this goes on till they can't stand it anymore. And in the second standard, there'll be 10 less of those kids. In the third standard, there'll be another 10 less. And then there'll be another 10 less. Fifth standard, there are three diligent, persevering students there, and they're reading their book, and they're petrified because their parents have said, you jolly well go. And they're reading the one book. This is happening. So we have to change it. Because the waste that is taking place in a country like Pakistan is tremendous. Human waste. This boy I showed you a picture of is teaching at Budapest University. He's a country boy from a village. How many country boys and girls from villages do you have? And where are they? They are staying in the country, and they are a drain on society. Because they don't have jobs. They don't have enough income. They don't pay tax. So something has to be done about it. It's in our hands. So you're doing a good job, because the schools are multiplying like mad. But it's only a fraction of the real problem. The real problem exists outside this room.
Thank you very much for a lovely, lovely lecture and the workshop that you're doing. My small question is that in spite of good salaries and the benefits we give to the children, the teachers' children, and the health benefits to the teachers, still some teachers show the laid-back attitude. So how can we change that, and we can inculcate the spirit of a real teacher into them?
How do you change the laid-back attitude?
Of the teacher.
Of the teachers.
Yeah.
Just sack them. They'll go get rid of some other school. No, I didn't mean that. They can go and work in a bank. Because everybody in the bank has a laid-back attitude. Any government service, they all have a laid-back attitude. Okay, I think they also require engagement. And it is up to the principal to start engaging them. You know, I've done so many workshops in this country, all over the place, from Quetta, Multan, Faisalabad, everywhere. And they say, oh, what a lovely talk, or what a lovely session, or 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours, science teaching, social studies, this, that, and the other. And I'm not actually improving their knowledge in science or improving their knowledge in English and so on. I'm talking about all the lessons that they give to children on a psychological level, which if they sort that out, so they're sorting themselves out as teachers, their children will learn much more and get much more out of the education that they've come there to get. Now, a lot of them will, after the session, say, it's not a secret. They will say, but our principal, if I did one bit of what you're talking about, you see, I'm telling you to sing. Every day, 5 minutes in the classroom, you want intonation, you want listening, you want them to enjoy the class. You want kids sitting down for hour after hour. It's not natural. They need to get up and they need to jump about and they need to do some. So you can do that, you know, and you can say, come on, 5 minutes, let's dance. Hey, do, 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 do. No, we can't sing because we will disturb everybody else. But there is singing and there is singing. We are in the jungle, we are in the jungle. It's going to disturb the next school down the road. But you can sing, I hear thunder, hark, don't you? He can't hear me in the next room. And this is singing, that's shouting. So, you know, it's all a way of doing things. Engage the teacher, trust the teachers, give them more responsibility, encourage them to do when they come up with any ideas, don't squash them. Discuss those ideas with them. See, I tell them to have a resource center in every school. Teachers clutch their resources and they walk around like this. I've made worksheets. I've done the research. I'll keep this. No, you have a cupboard to start off with. Then you have a room to start off with. And all the materials go in there. Labeled, this is for standard 3, standard 4, standard 5. Science, this is what I did. This is an interesting idea. Here's a worksheet. And anybody can take these and put them back. The first day you open that, half the stuff will disappear. Oh, this is good, I'll keep this. This selfishness. You share, you have meetings, and discuss there what you can do. Because ultimately, it's the children we are there for. So let's think of things that we can do to make their lives better and the learning better. Any more? That's it? Yes, sir.
Thank you for sharing with us. Very exciting, you know, this moment and wonderful experience that, you know, you have already, you know, this again and developed. My question is slightly different. You focus on ownership and engagement. Now, within that context, I wish if you could really share with us how does, you know, assessment, you know, does work in that, you know, context and how much, you know, importance you have given to assessment. So while you are doing these things are also, you know, being, you know, examined or assessed so that the kids, you know, should know that, you know, what kind of, you know, achievement they have been really, you know, gaining through the whole process.
Okay. Thank you. It's about assessment. In our school, there was constant assessment. There's constant evaluation. The teacher is sitting there. I should, if as a teacher, know every single one of my children. I should know their strengths and their weaknesses. I should know how fast they're going. I should know that when he has written an essay, that boy, he doesn't have a clue about certain things. And I will can take him back. So this system allowed it. Us to take people back, to revise, to go in a different direction, and so on. In your system, we just go on. We can't wait. We can't wait for the failures. You're going on at the teacher's pace. Nothing to do. You're going on at the book's pace. You're going on at the examination's pace. So at the end of the day, a child gets, and we tried to mention this a little bit, 86 marks, go. 24 marks, whoosh, do this again. Or the teacher is saying, when she gets the intake from the lower level, she got 40 kids coming up. That third standard teacher hadn't taught them anything. I have to start again from scratch. This one can't read, that one can't do this, that one can't do this. So they were, you know, all blaming somebody else. All blaming the system. And the system actually is terrible. Your children do exams. 3 months later, you set the same examination that they do. And then you mark them, and then you will see what a waste of time the whole thing is. So constant evaluation and self-evaluation. Your teachers waste hours correcting children's work. I give you dictation, 10 words. Collect all the papers, collect all the papers, bring all the papers, put all the papers here. Go and sit there, have no time to talk to your husband. What? I got to tick, 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 9. Sign it, put the date, well done. Next one, tuck, 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 tuck. In class, I can say, hey, just change your papers around. Here's the correct spelling. Pum, 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 pum. How many did you get? 10. How many did you get? 10. Cheat, liar. How many did you get? 10. How many did you get? 10. You know if the kid is bluffing, but at the end of the day, that kid is going to stop giving himself extra marks because he hasn't learned the words. He's going to learn those words. Right? Trust. Give them the trust. At the end, you can say, correct your own. Here's the answer sheet. And if he comes back with a suspicious-looking paper, which has got lots of rubbing out and scratches, this side, you know he's still cheating himself. So you can say, hey, look, did you write this to start off with? No. So do you know it? Okay, I'm going to shut the plate. Now write it again. He can't. Self-evaluation and evaluation on the spot. He has learned something and he can go forward. But in the system that we operate, you do a test today, I guarantee you, in 3 months, oh, but we didn't do this. How can we answer the questions? We have not thought outside the box. We have not used critical thinking. We have not used research and analysis. We have not used any of the things that we are talking about in jargon terms. The practical aspect of it is that child says, you have not taught this. In other words, you're teaching a parrot. You say, repeat after me. And even that will be forgotten in 3 months' time. Something has to be done. Oh, more innovative methods and more creative methods than you said about the teachers. Give them the leeway, give them the encouragement. Provide every support you can, and your teachers will produce the goods.